Yes, sir, baby, on the radar. Yo, it's a Friday when we record this. It's a beautiful day out in New York, and I got my girl here. Melena's here with me. What up?
Hello, hello.
Yo, first of all, thank you for calling in. I know it's a little early there on the West Coast, but I appreciate you being here with me today. You know, first of all, what I like to do when artists come on the show, especially during these times, I want to check in with you. How have you been during these crazy times that we've been living through for the past year?
I've been really good, you know, just trying to push, stay busy, be as creative as possible. So I've been working on a project and in and out of rehearsals and just preparing. So when the world opens back up again, we outside.
And you're, I mean, you've been dropping a couple singles like during the pandemic, of course, too. You know, obviously this year we have Ain't It Funny, which was so dope. And I love the cover art for Ain't It Funny. I thought that was awesome. And of course, the new record In My Whip is out now. When it came to creating during the pandemic, you know, did you find like, did you kind of try to take it easier, or like, what was kind of like your, how did you kind of handle the pandemic when it came to your music?
Honestly, it was a little rough in the beginning because I had released a project called Kaleidoscope, right, and I was going to go on a mini tour and just go to certain cities and, you know, promote the little EP that I had created. And then COVID hit. So it was kind of like, damn, like I wasn't able to go do anything. So it was a little rough in the beginning. And then I got back in the studio when people were allowing people to get back in the studio. And then, you know, the creative juices started flowing and things were back to normal. You just got to stay busy.
Because that project came out like literally at the end, like I think December, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So like you had like, I'm sure you had like a 3-month period where you were like planning on going on tour, yep, rehearsing, you know, getting the choreography, whatever else you were doing correct. And then right when you're ready to go, it's just like, everything went to shit. Yep.
It did. I was like, damn. And I was like, so, and like I just said to you earlier, like me and my team are so militant. So we had things lined up, ready to go, like, you know, the whole game plan. And then it kind of just got scrapped and just non-existent.
So when you go from like, you know, planning the tour to just kind of like becoming like what's the word that the word how the world just kind of shut down, became like stagnant, right? Right. What did you decide to do after that? Like, what was your kind of like, you know, mental state after that and kind of like figuring out what you want to do now? Because I think we all, even, you know, you and me doing this interview on Zoom, we're still in the adjustment of, you know,
right,
of COVID. So what did you end up, you know, wanting to do for yourself once everything shut down and you couldn't go on tour?
Well, when I couldn't go on tour, I was like, okay, well, we have to figure out certain ways to keep people still engaged with this project and for future things that are coming up. And so I started to hit social media. I started TikTok because before I wasn't, they were trying to get me on TikTok and I really wasn't on TikTok. And you know what? I literally stuck my foot in my mouth because I was like, TikTok's not going to take off. There's nobody's going to get on TikTok. Now everybody and their mother is on TikTok.
TikTok is the shit.
Right. So I went straight to social media platforms and I started my TikTok and then I grew that following. I started a little bit on YouTube and stuff. So I just hit straight to social media. And then, you know, when I seen everybody else come up with like creative things that kind of inspired me to do so. So and then I got back in the studio and, you know, just started to stay busy and start to plan for when things did open up. And now we're at that point and it's busy, busy, busy.
So with these singles, why, you know, when it comes to the music in 2021, why did you decide for these two singles to kind of be like, you know, the gearing up towards this new project, towards this new phase in your career, especially with, you know, when the last project came out, the tour, everything just kind of got really crazy and the world shut down. Why did you want like Ain't It Funny and In My Whip to kind of really be, you know, this new part of like the beginning of this new era for you?
I think because it's a new era in kind of hip hop, like nobody's really like rapping anymore, like, you know, in the pocket rapping like J. Cole status. I feel like everybody's doing like this melody rapping, like the Roddy Ricch wave, and everybody's on that, and which is hot right now. You know, I feel like everybody's, especially in the female like world, you know what I mean?
100%,
so everybody's in that world. And so I felt like, okay, like in the beginning I was thinking like, how am I gonna adjust to this? Because if you know me, I'm like a rapper. Like I have bars and I talk about real shit.
I watched your 92, your real 92 freestyle. I seen it.
Thank you. So yeah, so I was trying to figure out like how to pivot. And so I released Ain't It Funny to kind of just like laugh about it, because everybody, I would get into the studio with like my managers and stuff and they'd be like, you know, like you can do the melody rap, you could do it, but you just, I don't like certain subjects of rap these days in the female like world type of thing. So I came out with Ain't It Funny, and then I started to a little bit more. I was in the studio working on the melody stuff, and I actually was getting into it. That's how In My Whip came out. So it was nice to see that I was able to pivot that way and pivot back if I need to, if the game should change. So I'm very grateful for that.
Do you feel like it was a hard pivot for you, or do you feel like it was an easy pivot?
It was. I think it was a hard pivot for me. I think for people around me who got to see me in the studio, and it was easy for, like, you know, for me from the outside looking in. But for me to pivot that way was very, like, damn, you know, like, because I like rap and rapping. I like substance. I like that stuff. So especially when nobody's doing that right now, that was just like a different thing. So it was kind of like a bittersweet thing. But the melody rap shit's fun. It's fun. It's a new thing that I'm into right now. That's kind of what the whole project that I'm about to release very soon is going to be. And I'm having a lot of fun with it. And I'm really proud of myself, too, because that was like a big thing for me to do.
Right, because you got bars. You know what I'm saying? Ever since you first really blew up after the Cardi B stuff, like, you know, you've been known for spitting.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Even I think when I believe in the real 92 freestyle that I was, they was even like, they're like, yo, you don't look how you spit, but you come crazy. You know what I'm saying? So when it comes to, like, you know, obviously part of this new era, are you completely going with the melodic stuff? Or are you still going to kind of like throw a little bit of, you know, the
bars?
Yeah, the bars into it.
Yeah, I think that's exactly what I'm doing in this project. I gave you bars, and then I also gave you like the turn up records that are melodic and like that wave right now. But you know, I'm always gonna still rap. Like, I'm just very grateful that I could pivot to whatever hip hop stage is right now. You know what I mean? So yeah, but don't get it twisted, man. I can spit bars. Don't get it twisted.
If we put a mic in front of you, we put a beat on top, it's over.
Yeah. And that's like, I feel like that's exactly what like hip hop is missing right now, you know? Mm-hmm. I feel like everybody like lacks substance, but that's just my opinion.
No, totally. And you know what? I wanted to like get a little bit into like, you know, your backstory, because I was reading a little bit about your bio, and and I thought it was cool. So you went to like a performing arts high school, right?
Yeah.
And like, I'm assuming a lot of that was like classically trained to like music and whatnot. So how did you go from doing like classically trained music to hip hop? Like, how did that end up happening for you?
You know what? It's so weird, because I remember I was like wanting to go to this performing arts high school, and I was like, okay, cool, I'm gonna be able to do the music. I got in there and I was like, like I messed up. But it's good to know like the background of what you're getting into. I think because I went there and I was classically trained in like the book stuff and like the notes and like the OG stuff that goes into actually making music, I think that gave me like an extra point on, or a one up on other people in the industry. And it's just good. I think that was a good move for me, even though, like, you know, I wasn't being able to do the hip hop stuff that I wanted. And I think that I just stayed in my little zone. And I know I apply what I've learned from that school to every day in my music now. And my gosh, it helps a lot when you're doing keys, when you're making beats, like when you know the notes and how something's supposed to sound. Like, I'm very, very grateful I actually stuck it out at that school.
So at the end of the day, the classical stuff to some extent still helped you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Were you always a hip hop head?
Always
from the jump, from young age to now, always been a hip hop head.
Well, you know what? I grew up too listening to like old school shit. So not old school, but like real shit. So I listened to like Rick James and Tina Marie and the Four Tops. And then I got into like, when I got exposed to rap, I was like, whoa, what the hell is this? And so I just got lost in that world, from like Jay-Z to Nas to like Tupac and Biggie to like J. Cole now, and like just things. I fell in love with the substance and the words.
What's your earliest hip hop memory? Or like, what's your earliest like memory of hearing hip hop? You know what I'm saying? Cause I feel like some people have like that moment where they're like, I don't know, they heard Wayne for the first time, or they heard Biggie for the first time. Like, do you have one of those moments?
It was with Jay-Z and Alicia Keys, that Empire song, the Empire State. And I remember staying up to, I think I was 9 or 10. And I remember like trying to memorize his whole verse. like repeating it on YouTube with the lyrics and like trying to memorize his whole verse. And I think that was one of my earliest memories of like being turned on to hip hop.
I think that record came out in either 2008 or 2009. So you were probably like 8 or 9 when that came out then.
I think
it's so funny that it's that record. Because you know what I'm saying? It's like Empire State of Mind, You Live in California.
Right, exactly. Yeah. And I'm not even saying that because this is
You don't even know what he's talking about. You don't even know what he's talking about in it. Like some of the things, well, I mean, like some things obviously are, you know, pretty self-explanatory, but then there's like other I can't think of the verse off the top of my dome, but like I do know that there's like a bunch of things that's like, oh, you would only understand as if you had been to this part of the Bronx or you've been to like this part of Brooklyn, you know what I'm saying? So I think that that's funny how like. But that's kind of cool at the same time because it shows how far hip hop goes. You know what I'm saying? Like you're rapping about, you know, something going on in Brooklyn at this particular spot in this place. You never been there before, but you know this whole verse because of it.
Exactly. And that's why I loved it, because the way he like told the verse, like it was taking you through New York. I've never been to New York.
You still never been to New York. Oh, okay. You've been to New York.
I've been to New York. I did a Shade 45 interview with Lord Sear.
Hey, I used to intern for Lord Sear.
Yeah, I went to, I've been to New York, but at that time I was like, I was just tripping out listening to his verse and it was literally taking you through New York and I just fell in love with that.
That's incredible. That's a great story. Thank you for sharing that. I appreciate that. And also, okay, so now we got these singles out. We got the new EP. Is Evolution referring to kind of your shift in how you're doing some of these records? Like what does this Evolution EP mean to you?
I think it was a evolution in like the artist Milena. I think that this is definitely a new step in her career for her. It's a new sound. I'm definitely stepping out of my comfort zone on this one and I'm excited to share with everybody. Not only is it giving like my OG bars that I bring that everybody knows me for, it's also doing a little bit of what's on the radio and just like what's popping now, you know, the state of hip hop right now.
You said what's popping on. You got some radio records on there. Well, we already have some radio records out, but you got some more radio records on there. Are you doing anything else differently? Obviously, you know, with the melodic stuff, but is there anything else that you're playing around with? Anything else that you're trying something new with it?
A little bit of like the singing.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Was singing something you were classically trained on too, or how?
Yes. I'm all like, yes.
I felt the pain in your voice.
Yeah, dude. I used to hate choir. I remember thinking like, damn, do they have anything else here? Like, I had to be in choir. Like I just used to hate that class. And you know what's so funny is my teacher had, my choir teacher had DM'd me like just congratulating like on all the success and everything. And I told him, I was like, you know what? I got to give it to you. I hated going to your class, but all the things that you've taught me, I like literally put into play in my everyday life. And he's like, good. I'm glad. Like it was just a good moment.
That's incredible. Okay. So we got some singing on there. Do we know how many records is going to be?
Yes, it's going to be 8
records. Okay, cool. A nice little some for the summertime.
Yes.
What else do you have coming this year? What else do the people got to be on the lookout for? What else we got cooking? What else we got to make sure that that they got to stay in tune with? Oh, we have a show coming up. We got our first show back.
Yes, the first show back. And you know what? I'm very grateful too, because it's a big one. It is in Ontario, California on July 23rd with The Baby, Jack Harlow. Polo G, Bia, Rick Ross. It's a big show.
Hey,
it's
shout out Bia. Bia been on the show before. That's my sis.
I love Bia. OMG. I literally love Bia.
Is there a name for the show or is it a festival?
It's called Summer Unlocked.
Summer Unlocked. I love that. This is your first show back, right?
My first show back. So I've been in and out of rehearsal. And just like planning and trying to make sure everything's perfect, because after that we're taking off and we're going on tour.
Oh, dope. So you're hitting the ground running once this EP and everything comes out.
I'm telling you, dude, the pandemic really, like, I'm having withdrawals from performing, so I'm just trying to let's get it and go.
Look, as soon as I started doing in-person interviews again here in New York, it was like I had withdrawals from that. It's like a drug. It's like once you start doing it again, it's like, oh my God, I don't want to stop doing in-person interviews. Like I'm obsessed again. So I completely understand. Two different things, but also very similar at the same time.
Right. Gotta love what you do.
Yeah, exactly. You gotta love it. You know what? I'm very excited to see you perform. You know, hoping that we're gonna see you at like a Rolling Loud one day or one of these other festivals that are going on. Cause I know Rolling Loud does like a few festivals in California because we got LA. I think they do the Bay. I was gonna say,
they definitely bounce around Rolling Loud.
Yeah, so I'm hoping that we're gonna see you at one of those very, very soon. But you know, congratulations on this upcoming show. I can't wait to see you back. I can't wait to see the stories, the videos, the pictures, all that. What else do people gotta know? Let them know where they can follow you at. Anything else that you wanna let them know? Now is the time to go ahead and plug it in before we sign off.
Make sure you follow me on Instagram and TikTok. All of my handles are Malayna, M-A-L-A-Y-N-A-H, and subscribe to my YouTube channel because a lot of dope music videos are coming soon.
Hey, this is all very exciting. Thank you again for being here. I look forward to connecting with you once I finally get out to LA for the first time.
I know.
I have not been to LA ever, and I'm trying to come out this summer. You know, our guy Rosencrantz Vic be harassing me to come out there and do interviews.
Yeah, so, you have to.
So we're going to be out there this summer. But until next time, make sure y'all go run up those new singles. Be on the lookout for the EP this July, concerts, tours, all that stuff. Until next time, Malayna on the radar, baby.
Thank you. Boom.